Hey Harvest, Luke here. I'm out of town this weekend. So excited to welcome our guest speaker. Pastor Charlie Dates is a dear friend of mine. He pastors Progressive Baptist Church on the south side of Chicago. It does mean he's sort of a White Sox fan, but I won't hold that against him. He's speaking all over the world and is a really great minister of the gospel of Jesus Christ. He's gonna bring a great word that is gonna bless our church. Would you please put your hands together and give him a Harvest welcome right now, Pastor Charlie Dates.
This is the day that the Lord has made. We ought to rejoice today and be glad in it. I was glad when they said unto me, come, let us get up way early in the morning and drive to Rolling Meadows to the Harvest Bible Chapel, where our feet settle within the gates of our great God. Let me rush, please, to express my sincere and profound appreciation to Pastor James McDonald. What a mighty lion who yet roars. He is a brother, beloved, one who cares not only about the Word of God, but he cares about the people of God. And you are so fortunate to have him as your pastor. And let it be known that I am here to start the 30th year anniversary. I was not invited to start the 30th year anniversary. Robbie Zacharias was invited to start the 30th anniversary. But let it be known I am here to kick off the 30th. anniversary. Right? That's going to get me in trouble. And let me also publicly acknowledge my friend Luke McDonald. Man, you guys are in great hands. The Bible is clear that God gives us pastors. He gives us pastors based upon what he feels for us. And if the magnitude of the gift of pastors that you have is any indication of the magnitude of God's heart for you, God loves y'all a whole lot. And so we're very grateful to be with you. I'm not here today by myself. In 7 days, a week from today, she will have been my wife for 12 years. She's here with me today, Kiersey Elizabeth. I'd like to say it in language that I feel she is the sugar in my Kool-Aid, the fire in my fireplace, and she is the vibranium of my Wakanda. I know you guys don't know what that is, but that's who she is. And then our two children are here, Charlie and Claire. They got up early this morning to do the drive with us too, and very grateful to have them. And to the Harvest staff, everybody been great. Thank you. Another brother from our church is here, Virgis Island. He serves with us, and so Lottie, Dottie, and everybody. I wanted to send a shout out to everybody today. I want to preach this morning what I hope will be an encouraging word to you. 1 Samuel chapter 30 is our passage this morning. I want to read into your hearing the first 8 verses of 1 Samuel chapter 30. And then after we read the first 8 verses, I'd like to read verses 16 through 20 of that same chapter. As you turn there this morning, let me say this to you. What is theological is not always logical. And what is often logical is not theological. And so what that means is that the child of God has to learn to assess life and circumstances from the Word of God, the perspective of God, and trust that in the sovereignty and providence of God, that God will work that out, even if his Word works against your natural reaction. That's where we meet a young David. Some scholars suggest he's in his late 20s when we get to 1 Samuel chapter 30. Let's hear today how he hands to us through the hallways of Scripture some words, some encouragement about how God will speak to you in your low moments. And if you take a hold of his word, he will turn the circumstance to be better than you could conceive. Beginning at verse 1, I'm reading from the New American Standard Bible, and this is how my Bible reads. It says, "Then it happened when David and his men came to Ziklag on the third day that the Amalekites had made a raid on the Negev and on Ziklag and had overthrown Ziklag and burned it with fire. And they took captive the women and all who were in it, both small and great, without killing anyone, and carried them off and went their way. When David and his men came to the city, behold, it was burned with fire, and their wives and their sons and their daughters had been taken captive. Then David and the people who were with him lifted their voices and wept until there was no strength in them to weep. Now David's two wives had been taken captive, Ahinoam the Jezreelitess and Abigail, the widow of Nabal the Carmelite. Moreover, David was greatly distressed because the people spoke of stoning him. For all the people were embittered, each one because of his sons and his daughters. But David strengthened himself in the Lord his God. Then David said to Abiathar the priest, the son of Ahimelech, please bring me the ephod. So Abiathar brought the ephod to David. And David inquired of the Lord, saying, shall I pursue this band? Shall I overtake them? And he said to him, pursue, for you will surely overtake them, and you will surely rescue all. Go down with me to verse 16. When he had brought them down, behold, they were spread over all the land, eating and drinking and dancing because of all the great spoil that they had taken from the land of the Philistines and from the land of Judah. David slaughtered them from the twilight until the evening of the next day, and not a man of them escaped except 400 young men who rode on camels and fled. So David recovered all that the Amalekites had taken and rescued his two wives, but nothing of theirs was missing, whether small or great, sons or daughters, spoil, or anything that they had taken for themselves. David brought it all back. So David captured all the sheep and the cattle, which the people drove ahead of other livestock, and they said, this is David's spoil. In 1 Samuel chapter 30, we meet David in one of the dark nadir moments of his life. He teaches us how to handle similar moments, does he not? All right. I know it's early, and I know you're the early service. A quick word on the history of black preaching in America. It's a quick word. It of all of its wonderful trademarks, it is dialogical. And so what that means is there is some kind of exchange that happens between the pulpit and where you sit. Now, I know for some of you that's not you. You're not going to say anything, and I'm A-okay with that. I really am. I'm all right. Just look a man. If you cannot say it, just look it, and then that way I know that I'm tracking with you, and we can move further. So in this passage, David shows us how to handle moments, low moments, troublesome moments, and crises. Does he not? And that's what I want to talk with you about this morning. I want to tag this text in our exchange, learning to move with God. I want to talk about learning to move with God. Will you pray with me, please? Our Father and our God, thank you so much for your darling son, Jesus, who is our all-sufficient prophet, priest, and king. Thank you, Lord, that we have help and hope in him, that there is no circumstance we can face that he is not strong enough to overcome and to see us through. And I pray today that you will use me like a heavenly courier to encourage the hearts and the minds of your people. I don't know who's here today who needs this encouragement, but would you, God, tailor these precious minutes to speak directly to their circumstance so that they leave here with greater confidence and hope in you. Give me, I pray, clarity of mind, concision of speech, and conviction of heart, that I may tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, for your glory and our good. In Jesus' name, amen. Her name is Maggie Baranquitse. Maggie has been called the Mother Teresa of Burundi. Burundi is a cousin country to Rwanda. And Rwanda, many of us know, is popularly known for the genocide that took place there. But what is not so popularly known is that Burundi suffered its own ethnic genocide. Two tribes committed to the annihilation of the other. It was so bad that there were priests who were cooperating with terrorists, co-conspiring with them to move their parishioners, even on Sunday, into the hands of opposing tribes. Maggie could have left Burundi, but instead of leaving, she decided to stay and to, watch this, build an orphanage for children who were left behind by the ethnic conflict. With little to no state funding, she literally built an orphanage that became a haven, a home for these children, and raised them in all kinds of skills. Many of them went on to colleges and universities to develop professional skills, and some of them have come back to serve that very orphanage. She literally raised a new nation. Rather than leaving when she could have, when the conflict broke out, Maggie used that catastrophe as a catalyst for real change. She shows us that catastrophes, that crises, that moments of trouble, that low nadir moments do not have to deconstruct us, but they actually can become classrooms in which we learn faith and patience and dependence upon God. If handled rightly, your moments and my moments of unexpected difficulty, of darkness and pain, can actually propel us so that we come out stronger, wiser, more faithful, and fuller on the back end than we were when we went in. And let me just say this, the way my college pastor used to say it, you can ease up because every man builds his house in the pathway of a storm. Men and women weep and laugh in all languages and all cultures. We all find low moments at some point in our lives. He would say this, you're either in a crisis right now or you've come out of one or keep on living. One is going to find you. It's like that annoying piece of mail that sometimes comes to our home. It doesn't have our name on it. It just says to the resident at, and it gives the address. In other words, we get some mail simply because we take up space. Part of living life is that some trouble comes just because you're here. And what we learn from this, as a good segue in our passage, is that God does not leave his children in their low moments. And God is not surprised by the things that surprise you. That's the story of young David as we come up to 1 Samuel chapter 30. David is the leader of a 600-man army, a kind of motley group. He was anointed king over Israel, and it was his anointing that invited trouble by his father-in-law, his erratic, egomaniacal, narcissistic father-in-law, could not stand the fact that God had picked him to be king and rejected Saul as king. Isn't this interesting that it was not something David did wrong to invite trouble, but it was simply because God's hand was on David that Saul could not handle David? This disrupts the theology of many people who feel like the moment you start walking with God, all of your problems will go away. That when you trust God and you do things right, you won't have to run into difficulty and trouble. But can we use David as an example this morning? That sometimes it's because you walk with God. It is because God's hand is on your life that the enemy will seek to unnerve you and undo you. And so sometimes trouble is a compliment. It is not that there's something wrong with you, but sometimes it's saying there's something right about you. And when you trust God, you will experience some of these strange moments. That's what David is. 600 men. This, by the way, though, isn't the kind of church you want to pastor. 600 men, their wives and their children. These guys, according to 1 Samuel chapter 22, they were in debt. They were distressed and they were discontented. In debt, distressed, and discontented. One of those is bad all by itself. But when you put all that together, you have a group of men who find nothing joyous and happy about life. And David has to live his life on the run with this group. He has to live his life on the run because his father-in-law wants to kill him and sought to kill him more than once. And although his father-in-law sought to kill him, David sought revenge not once. And once David discovers he's safe nowhere, he goes to the post office and changes his address. He relocates to a land called Ziklag. It's a land given him by the Lord of the Philistines. Did you hear what I just said? He goes to move to Ziklag. You're in a bad place when you change your zip code to Ziklag. Ziklag is the land apportioned him by the Lord of the Philistines. Now, you don't have to have been in church for a year to know that's a problem. David killed a soldier from Gath, a man named Goliath, their champion, who was a Philistine, and nobody wanted to fight Goliath. Rerun here. Nobody wanted to take him on. David comes with his little lunch bag to his brothers, and he says, "Why y'all hiding? What's wrong? What are you scared of? Get down, David, get down. You're going to talk too loud and bring attention to us. Who are you afraid of? That giant." Nobody will fight the giant. And David says, "I'll fight him." He's a young, ruddy teenager, and in this moment, King Saul says to him, "Well, man, we can't send you out there, but if you want to go, I'll give you my armor." And David says, "No, that's too big, it's too heavy. I'll go down by the river, and I'll pull 5 smooth stones, and with a rag and a rock," the first concealed carry semi-automatic weapon in the Bible, David swirls it around his head, slings it, and the Bible says that the stone penetrates right between the eyes of Goliath, and he knocks him down, and he runs up on him in a story of might and confidence in God, takes Goliath's sword, cuts his head off, raises his head up to the Philistines and says, "You want more?" And they run and they flee. David single-handedly puts a whole nation and their army on the run. And now in 1 Samuel chapter 30, that's where he finds solace. This was the, as a matter of national policy, this was the conviction of the Philistines to try to defy the God of the armies of Israel. You're in a bad place when you move to Ziklag. And I don't know who I'm preaching to here today, but somebody here is living in Ziklag. You can't find comfort with the people who are supposed to love you. You're not finding solace in the normal right places. And it seems like your enemies are kinder to you than the folk who should love you and take care of you. And then the worst possible scenario arises. It's about a year and 4 months into his time living in Ziklag. King Achish and the Philistine army are about to go into war again. This time, guess with who? Israel. And David is obliged to go fight with them against the armies of Israel. Problem. His brothers are in that army of Israel. His father-in-law is head of that army. These are his native people. And so the lords of the Philistine come to King Achish and say, "Listen, we know you like David. We know he's loyal, but he can't go with us. You can't go with us to fight this battle. What better time for David to prove his loyalty and to win Saul back by turning on us in the middle of the battle? So King Achish goes to David and says, David, man, you're loyal. I appreciate you, but the guys don't want you to go with me. You cannot go. And thus the Lord delivers David. On their way back from the war camp station, about 55 miles south, as they approach Ziklag, their land, that which has been apportioned to them, they see clouds of dark smoke hurtling up into the air. You can hear the whispers of the men. What is this? What is going on? You can see men starting to drop their armor, running to the scene, and they come to Ziklag, and they notice that their homes are burned down, that their wives are gone, their sons are gone, their daughters are gone. Look at verse 3 at the almost staircase nadir literary description of the Hebrew writer. When David and his men came to the city, behold, it was burned with fire, and their wives and their sons and their daughters had been taken captive. This is written in a way that is meant to make you and I drop with every description. And their wives, and their sons, and their daughters. Friends, this is like the book of Job times 600. Everything they know and love, everyone they know and love is gone. And when the crime scene investigators come up and look at the burning embers, they cannot tell who did it or in which direction they went. You see David trying to pull up his ADT app on his phone to watch the camera footage and who came in and who went out. It's one thing for the bottom to fall out. It's another thing to not know what step one is toward recovery. The Bible says that these men, and these are mighty men of courage, valor, and integrity, these men wept until there was no more strength in them to weep. I don't know if you've ever had a cry like that. I've had some of those tears before where you cry until you cannot, you physically cannot cry anymore. And then they get bitter. They say, David, we're going to kill you. You're the reason we're in this predicament. And David in this moment teaches us how to handle these moments. He teaches us how to move with God. He turns to God, and God gives him a solution to his problem in a way that blesses him exceedingly and abundantly above what he could have asked or even imagined. And this is what we learn, friends. We learn how to handle these crises-like moments. Not on our own wisdom, not by calling our best friend, but by seeking the face of God. And I want to suggest to you, our nation is in one of these moments. It doesn't matter how you parse it. It's some strange stuff happening in these yet to be United States of America. And unfortunately, the church has often been complicit in some of the strange things happening. It's not just nationally, but it's locally. I mean, our church, about 4 weeks ago, a young man, he had just graduated from high school 2 weeks before. He was out at a party. He had no gang affiliation, no weapon. He was shot in the head, and he was laying on the ground dying, and the paramedics left him there for about 45 minutes to an hour, assuming he was dead and he was alive. He's gone now, and his parents find themselves in a strange place in life. And that doesn't have to be your circumstance. You keep living and you discover that maybe your kids don't live the way you raised them. Maybe they don't go to school and do what you taught them to do, and you don't know what to do. Maybe money gets funny and change gets strange. It doesn't matter what the affliction is, they come. The question is, how do we handle them? And how do we walk in life when they come? Listen, friends, although you can do nothing about nightmare-like crises, and although they come and they seek to undo the very fabric of your life, I want to suggest to you today that you're in the right place. Because here, by the word of God, as you hear it proclaimed, as you read it, as you trust it, you can find direction that will lead you to a better than expected end. God has a word for you. When trouble strikes and the bottom falls out, that's where you learn that there's a rock at the bottom. That's why we call it rock bottom. And his name is Jesus Christ. That when you get there, you discover that God has all power in his hands and that there is nothing beyond the reach or the purview of his sovereignty. Amen. Learn to move with God, friends. And when you and I learn to move with God, we discover that God remembers his word. He doesn't fail there. Look with me at verse 1 of chapter 30. Then it happened when David and his men came to Ziklag on the third day that the Amalekites had made a raid on the Negev and on Ziklag and had overthrown Ziklag and burned it with fire. There's a problem in there. I wonder if you felt it just by me reading it. It happened when David and his men came to Ziklag on the third day, that the Amalekites, there it is, that's a problem. You Bible readers know why that's a problem. You remember way back in Exodus 17, when the children of Israel under Moses' leadership were unfairly treated by Amalek and his sons. And they got into a battle, and Moses' hands are lifted up on the top of that mountain. And as long as his hands are lifted up, the children of Israel are winning down in the valley. But when his hands come down, the children of Israel start losing. And so they come up and they prop up Moses' hands so that the children of Israel can prevail. And God comes to Moses and says, Mo, I got a problem with Amalek and his sons for coming against you in the way that they did. I'm going to utterly destroy Amalek from the face of the earth. And then years later, decades later, scores later, centuries later, Israel ends up getting a king. Bad idea, but they wanted one. And so God gave them a king, and his first military assignment was to go and destroy, utterly destroy the Amalekites, because God was keeping his word. And then they get into battle, and King Saul, who's already insecure and selfish, starts to be approached by some of his men. Saul, do we really have to kill all of these sheep and goats? I mean, I don't even have any goats, man. Look at that little goat. That'll go great at my house. And my daughter would really appreciate that. Bah. Saul, we don't have to destroy all of this grain. We could take some of this. Or look at them. We could keep them as our own servants. And watching the Gallup poll, Saul sees the potential for his numbers to rise. And he decides, rather than destroying what God told him to destroy, that he would keep it. Friends, we're in trouble whenever we make as pets the cattle God has told us to destroy. We are in trouble whenever we do not remove what God has told us to remove. But you know what I've come to learn in pastoring? Oftentimes, we don't get rid of the stuff God tells us to get rid of. We repurpose it. We push it to a different area. But that creates a problem, because in 1 Samuel chapter 30, David gets attacked by somebody Saul should have killed. And when you don't destroy the Amalekites, they will come after your children. When you do not destroy what God tells you to destroy, succeeding generations will have to put up with what their forefathers would not get rid of. And I want to suggest to you that that's part of the problem we're facing in America today. My generation is having to face trauma and difficulty that the previous generation should have faced and put to death. But I came today to tell you and to encourage you, kill the Amalekites in your house. Kill the Amalekites around you. Don't let your children and your grandchildren have to face some things you should put away. God remembers his word. But it's trouble when we don't put those things away. He not only remembers his word, but watch this, friend. He proves that his word is enough. My soul is happy. Y'all pray for me. My soul is happy. I'm really trying to be restrained and refined because I like y'all, pastor, and stuff, and we got a good relationship. and I don't want y'all to go telling no story like he was too much, but when I read stuff like this, this amazes me. You've got two responses to the unexpected attacks, bitter, nadir moments of life. You can either be bitter or you can choose the route of blessing. Look at the text here. The Bible says in verse 6, moreover, David was greatly distressed because the people spoke of stoning him, for all the people were embittered, each one because of his sons and his daughters. But David, to feel that contrastive conjunction, but David strengthened himself in the Lord his God. They got bitter. They started saying, David, you're the one who's responsible for us. And let me tell you, that is a way you could go in life. Bitter people kill the very folk who love them the most. They blame them. But rather than being bitter, you can choose the route of blessing, which is going to the face of God and asking him for direction in the moment of your crisis. The Bible says, but David strengthened himself in the Lord his God. He said to Abiathar the priest, the son of Ahimelech, please bring me the ephod. So Abiathar brought the ephod to David, and David inquired of the Lord, saying, shall I pursue this band? Will I overtake them? The problem in the text, problem, the ephod is a garment to be worn by priests only. David is not a priest. It's made of the extreme grade fabric that ultimately creates the veil in the Holy of Holies. It is bedazzled and decked out with jewels. It has gold rings that attach it over the shoulders and the arms. It is meant to say, God, you don't see my flesh. You see something pure and holy and wonderful, and I need you to talk back to me right now. It was not to be trampled with. It was not to be toyed with. In fact, it was only to be worn by priests. But in his moment of greatest affliction, David goes to the priest and says, I need you to get out the way. I need to go talk to God myself. And let me tell you, friends, that there are moments in life where you ain't got time for a mediator. You ain't got time to call your pastor, your small group leader, your mama, your daddy, your kids. You better learn how to fall on your own knees at home. Open your mouth and call upon the name of the Lord. But can I tell y'all something? King Jesus really is listening when you pray. We got a God who hears and answers prayer. Prayer ought to be our first response, not our last resort. Prayer is not passive resignation to life's circumstances, but prayer is a potent revolution. When you pray, you say, God, I've got all the confidence in the world in you, and I know you can handle this. But I know, the problem with some of us is the problem with many churches around the country. We don't really believe prayer works. We say we do, but we don't. I brought my own witness. I knew you wouldn't say anything to me. In small town Mount Vernon, Texas, the Drummond's Bar and Grill was scheduled to open up across the street from a church, right down the road, rather. The church didn't want the bar and grill to open up in their neighborhood. They didn't want their kids to be around to see all of this activity. And so you know what they did? They called a prayer meeting, and they started to pray, God, please stop that bar and grill from being built. When about 75% toward completion, the bar and grill had been built, a storm hit Mount Vernon, and lightning struck the building and burned it down to the ground. Church rejoiced that their prayers had been answered until they got a subpoena in the mail. Turns out that Mr. Drummond was suing the church because he had heard about this prayer meeting. They go stand before the judge. And when they stand before the judge, Mr. Drummond's attorney says, Your Honor, my client is here to sue the church. We're convinced that their prayers are responsible for the burning down of this building. To which the church's attorney said, No, my clients take no responsibility for lightning hitting that building. The judge replied in her early remarks, I don't know how I'm going to rule, but one thing that's clear to me, the tavern owner believes in the power of prayer, and the church does not. Friends, what an indictment that there are others who see us pray and know that our God answers when we pray, but we who pray do not believe that God answers. And David falls on his knees and he says, God, will I get them? Should I go? And if I go, will you give them? And this, the Bible says, strengthens David. David strengthened himself in the Lord his God. In other words, David found strength that was external to him. And it got inside of him. This is the idea of being encouraged. It is putting strength on the inside. In other words, you cannot make it in life on your own strength. You cannot make it on your own ability, wit, and intellect. You need power that comes from outside of you. Someone who is greater, omniscient, omnipotent, omnibenevolent, who knows all things to take care of you. I learned this not in seminary. I learned this on Saturday mornings watching my favorite cartoon growing up, Popeye the Sailor Man. Oh, that my kids could see Popeye. Popeye was an extraordinary young sailor man. He had a love affair with a woman named Olive Oil. But I gotta confess, I never saw in Olive Oil what Popeye saw in Olive Oil. As discerning as a child's eyes are to beauty, I never saw it. A really pencil thin, big hair, annoying voice, all of that. But I learned some things. Popeye was loyal to his girl. And Popeye had an antagonist who wanted his girl. His name, Brutus, big burly, ugly looking. I mean, he looked like his breath smelled bad from the TV screen. And he was big and burly, and he would come in and he would beat up Popeye every episode. I mean, one episode I distinctly remember, he hit him with an uppercut and he knocked Popeye over towns and villages and cities until he landed somewhere else. And then Popeye would be laying there and he came and he started to go to restaurants and clean tables with Popeye. But I didn't watch Popeye every Saturday to watch him get beat up. I watched Popeye every Saturday waiting on that one moment when Popeye would say, I done took all I can take. Help me, Lord. I done stood for all I could stand. Me can take no more. And somewhere, you wouldn't even know where it came from. Maybe on his belt, it would be some beat up can of spinach, and he would get it out, and he would pop the top, and it would jump out in their CG graphics. It would jump out, and it would get into him, and then he would blow up, and he would start to beat down the same enemy that was beating him down, because he needed strength outside of himself to get in him so that he could face what was facing him. Friends, I'm trying to preach to y'all this morning. I ain't got spinach to give you. I cannot send you to Whole Foods or Trader Joe's, but I can send you to the Word of God. And when you get this Word on the inside of you, come on now, y'all read some of it. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures, leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. When you get that inside of you, greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. But my God will supply all of your needs according to his riches and glory. For I know the plans that I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you. Fret not thyself because of evildoers, neither be thou envious against the workers of iniquity, for they shall soon be cut down and wither as the green herb. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. When you get that Word, help me, Holy Ghost. When you get that Word on the inside of you, you can face what's facing you. Friends, God's Word is enough. It's enough. It is sufficient to meet us in all of our low moments. God says to David, go, man. And when you go, I want you to know something. You're going to get it all back. He says, when you follow my word, everything you lost is going to come back to you. David starts to pursue, and he just so happens to land upon an Egyptian slave. They give him some cakes and some raisins,
some water and he revives him. And David says, hey man, some guys made a raid on the Negev the other day. Do you know who they are? And the man says, I do. He said, that's my master and them. They left me for dead. David said, hey man, can you take us to where they are? And he says, I can if you promise not to turn me in. David said, you ain't got nothing to worry about. It just so happens that at that moment, in that open field, they left that slave who knew exactly where they were. It just so happens. But friends, might I suggest to you that there is nothing in life as it just so happens? But that the providence of God has already calculated every contingency of your life. So that when you move on his word, he has everything you need right in place when you get there. The Bible says that David and his men came up on them. And he saw them strewn out everywhere. They were celebrating at this point. You could see the empty bottles of Hennessy and Don Julio, Jim Beam. What's the bourbon they make in Kentucky? Yeah, y'all ain't want to say it. You know what it is. It's the special aged stuff. And they are sprawled out everywhere. And there's music playing on the loudspeakers. There are little prawns half eaten laying across the field. They've had a good time. And as the music is thumping, they are clueless that David has shown up. And the Bible says in verse 17 that David slaughtered them from the twilight until the evening of the next day. Do y'all read that in your Bible? That from the twilight until the evening of the next day, David took them down. And only a few of them got away. And the Bible says, I love this in verse 19, but nothing of theirs was missing, whether small or great, sons or daughters, spoil or anything that they had taken for themselves. David brought it all back. But here is what you want to notice. The Bible tells us that David got not only what was taken from him, but David got what they had taken from everybody else. In verse 16, it says that they were eating and dancing because of all the great spoil that they had taken from the land of the Philistines and from the land of Judah. Watch it now. David gets not only what he lost, but he gets what they took from other people. I wish I had my church in here this morning. Y'all just let me get out of this sermon right here, right now. The way God works is that when you go through difficulty and you follow his word and you stick true to him, he'll give you more on the outside than you had when you went on the inside. I can barely contain it. I know how this works. Oh, a few years ago, Claire wasn't born yet. We had gotten home from a lunch meeting and we got into the house and noticed that there was stuff strewn in the condo everywhere in the bedroom. And I said, dear, did you do this? She said, no, I went to another room and computers were gone. Televisions had been taken off of the wall. And I noticed at that moment we had been robbed. I don't know if you've ever felt that way before, violated and down. And I felt terrible and I was in a funk for at least 24 hours. And then it hit me. We have this thing. Some of you have it. It's called insurance. I called the agent. I said, you won't believe what happened. It took me 24 hours to recognize we got you, man. And something happened. They took everything. And he said, well, did you file a police report? I said, yes. He said, make an itemized list. I'm going to send you some papers. Record everything you can with the receipts. Send us everything you got. He said, and don't worry, Pastor Dates. You're in good hands with Allstate. I filled out all of the paperwork. I submitted it. A few weeks later, I was in Dallas, Texas, preaching. I was headed to the airport when my phone rang, and it was someone from the claims office with Allstate. Said, Mr. Dates, we processed your claim. Just wanted you to be on the alert that by the time you get home, there should be a check there for you, and we hope that you are pleased with the amount that we give you. I said, well, I hope I'm pleased, too. They said, well, give us a call when you get home. And Pastor Dates, you're in good hands. with Allstate. I got home, and sure enough, that check was in the mailbox. I brought it upstairs, and I looked at it. I said, Kirsten, you got to see this. This is more than what we asked for. I called the agent. I said, hey, man, I don't want to get in no trouble. This is more than what we asked for. He said, oh, no, 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 you're not in trouble. He said, you told us what you spent when you bought that stuff years ago, but we have to pay you what it costs to get it right now. So you get more than what you lost. Oh, blessed be the name of the Lord. Y'all don't know where I'm going yet. That's the story of every Christian. We got something better than Allstate. It's called a hill Calvary. Golgotha, where God let his son be strung up between two thieves with nails in his hands and a nail in his feet and spear in his side and a crown of thorns upon his head. And there at Calvary, God gave us more than what we lost in Eden. He gave us our hope back, our peace back, our joy back, united fellowship with him. And now we're richer and stronger and better. Glory to the name of our great God.